And now we move on to our next speaker, Dr. Srinivas UM, who would be speaking to us about headache in the clinic. When should one be worried? A few words about Dr. Srinivas. Dr. Srinivas is a consultant neurologist at Arunai Neuro Center, Saligramam. He is also a visiting consultant at Bevel Hospitals, Annanagar, Bharati Raja Hospital, T Nagar, Maya Nursing Home, and KM Nursing Home. He is an MBBS. He got his MBBS from MMC in 2012, and he completed his MD in internal medicine from MMC in 2017, and completed DM neurology from MMC in 2020, and his SE in neurology from UK in 2020 as well. He's got quite a number of awards. He's a winner of C.T. Thompson Prize in Anatomy, winner of Edmund Laureate Prize for Best Postgraduate in Internal Medicine. He is also a Torrent Young Scholar Award in Neurology. Over to you, Dr. Srinivas.
Thank you, ma'am. May I start sharing the screen now?
Just please do.
At the outset, I would like to thank the IMA Kodambakkam for this opportunity. This talk is a primarily clinically based talk. So this is about headache in the clinic. When should one be worried? That is, when would I be worried if I see...
We are unable to hear you, Dr. Srinivas.
Can you hear me, ma'am? Hello? Can you hear
yes,
me?
Yes, we can hear you now. Yes, we can.
Okay. This talk is primarily about headache in the clinic. When should one be worried? That is, when would I be worried in a patient with headache? So I just started a series of cases. So this is the first case I would like to share about. It's a 20-year-old college student who came with new onset headache for 3 months. It is predominantly bifrontal. And he has some pain in the back of the head and neck as well. He says the headache is persistent and dull in nature. And he also says that it seems worse if he has been standing for some time and is better if he lies down. The pain also increases whenever he coughs or sneezes. He has no associated symptoms and his examination is normal. So this is the MRI of the patient. What we see here in this is a T2-weighted image showing a mild increase in the subdural space and a contrast showing enhancement, severe enhancement of the meninges. So this is the image, a sagittal image showing there's a tenting of the cerebellum and there's a downward drag of the brainstem as well. So this gives the diagnosis of intracranial hypotension in this patient. So on further questioning, he says that he's a football player in college and he has suffered a forceful tackle with the injury to his lower back around 4 months back. So his MR myelogram revealed epidural CSF collection anteriorly at the thoracic level. So the next case I would like to share. It's a 26-year-old female who's married, she's without kids. He has complaints of new onset headache for the past 30 days. Her pain is holocranial, but severity is maximal in the frontal areas. It's maximal in the early morning and the patient usually wakes up with headache. On further questioning, she mentions that she experiences worsening on bending forward and on coughing and straining at stools. This is usually associated with a brief blackening of the vision and examination reveals bilateral papillary edema. So on imaging of this patient, we can see that this is the empty cella and there is a tortuosity of the bilateral optic nerves. This creates a classical presentation of intracranial hypertension. And on a further question, patient says has been taking lithium for a diagnosis of bipolar disorder for the past 2 months. And formal visual field testing shows constriction of the bilateral visual fields. So this is this gives a patient a diagnosis of drug-induced intracranial hypertension. So this next case, scenario which I show, is a 67-year-old man, the complaints of headache on and off for the past 2 months, which is holocranial, and it tends to increase on coughing and straining at stools. On examination, there are no signs of raised intracranial tension. And neurological examination was normal. However, he is a known case of coronary artery disease. He is on aspirin and clopidogrel daily. So imaging of this patient showed a CT scan showing the chronic with SDH with an acute component with the midline shift. This is a acute on chronic SDH. So the patient recalls that he knocked his head against the door frame while getting into his car 2 months back. This is the one history which he did not remember initially, which came out only on further questioning after we saw the imaging act. So coming to the next case, it's a 22-year-old female who just delivered her first child 5 days back. So she had headache, which is sudden onset since today morning, and it's holocranial and severe and associated with recurrent vomiting, but no complaints of nausea, and she did not have any other complaints. Examination also revealed bilateral blurring of the temporal margins of the disc. So imaging as this patient has an urgent imaging was done and showed obliteration of the spaces in the superior sagittal sinus, and the MR venogram showed non-visualization of the superior sagittal sinus. So this is a diagnosis of a coronary venous sinus thrombosis of the superior sagittal sinus. There's another case, which is a 32-year-old male who's working as a salesman, complaint of headache, just sudden onset since morning 5 a.m. He had woken from sleep due to the pain. He has vomited 6 times since then. And he feels his neck is stiff since morning. And he has pain when bending forward. He is irritated on looking at light and does not cooperate for examination of his eyes. His examination revealed neck stiffness, and his left pupil was 4 millimeter, not reacting to light. And on examination, his left eye depression was impaired. So urgent imaging showed the subarachnoid hem bleed bilaterally in the Sylvian fissures with an aneurysm in the PCOM. So it's a left PCOM aneurysm rupture, subarachnoid hemorrhage. So on further questioning, he says he has been having intermittent double vision for the past 2 weeks, which he had attributed to his power change in his glasses. And so he had not mentioned it when questioning about his history. And occasional retroorbital pain had also been there for the past 2 weeks. So this is another case who's a 32-year-old female, complains of severe headache for 2 days, just holocranial. However, she says that it is more on the right side and it's throbbing in nature. She's been having nausea and vomiting, photophobia and phonophobia. She has taken paracetamol for the pain, but it did not resolve. Further questioning, she says she has had at least 5 to 6 headaches per month for the past 6 years. And the headaches are usually unilateral with nausea and photophobia, and they last usually 4 to 5 hours. The headache usually resolves, and she does not take any prophylactic medications for the same. Imaging of this patient was normal. So we ended up with the diagnosis of migraine with a severe exacerbation. So what we have to note here is that the pattern and character of the headache is the same as the previous attacks, and only the severity and the duration is higher than usual. So coming to the patient who's 40-year-old female, headache for the past 6 years. Initially, it was around 4 to 5 times a month. For the past 5 months, it has increased to almost 20 times a month of headache. It used to resolve with paracetamol and last around 2 to 3 hours initially. Now, patient says she uses Tramadol and Zolpidem nasal sprays for every attack, and the duration has also increased to 78 hours. The pain remains unilateral and more commonly on the left with nausea and photophobia. The examination is normal. So this history is classical of a medication overuse headache. So I'll discuss why later. And the last patient is a 75-year-old male, no comorbidities, with headache for the past 2 months. Pain is bilaterally in the temporal regions, and patient has also noticed tenderness of the scalp on attempting to comb the hair. On examination, no differences were found. On MRI imaging, a plain imaging appeared normal, whereas a contrast showed an inflammation of the vessel wall in the temporal arteries. So this patient, the diagnosis of giant cell arteritis. He has had complaints of claudicating pain in the left jaw while eating for the past 2 months. So whenever you see a patient of headache who's presenting in the OP, we need to look at the red flags. What are these red flags? This is given by a small mnemonic called SNOOP. So this is systemic symptoms or illness associated, that is say the fever, altered level consciousness, anticoagulation, pregnancy, cancer, HIV infection. And you look for any neurological symptoms associated with the headache, such as papillary edema, cranial nerve dysfunction, motor dysfunction, or cerebellar dysfunction. You should also look at the onset, whether it is recent or sudden onset, you should always raise a red flag. Or you should look for onset after the age of 40. So any headache presenting after 40 should always be looked at with suspicion for a secondary cause. And the prior headache history is very important, since if it is definite, especially if it is different or progressive from before. A different location is usually less useful as a predictor. And you always look at the pain response to standard headache therapy is not predictive. That is, a secondary headache may also respond to a standard paracetamol tablet. So you should not use this as a criteria for ruling out a secondary headache. So this is a list of red and orange flags, but most of the things, they give you clues to the underlying diagnosis. That is, systemic symptoms can occur due to infection, intracranial disorders, carcinoid of pheochromocytoma, neoplasms in history, usually suggests either a metastasis or a primary neoplasm in the brain. If there's a deficit, neurological deficit, you should look at vascular causes, intracranial masses, or brain abscess or infection. If the headache is sudden or abrupt, the clue should be also, you should always suspect a subarachnoid hemorrhage and other vascular headaches involving the cranial or cervical vasculature. If the onset is after 50, genital arthritis always should top the chart of suspicions, and other headaches, including the vascular headaches, should always be thought of as, along with your neoplasms. If there's a change in the pattern or a recent onset of headache, think of neoplasms and vascular and other intracranial disorders, whereas a positional change in the headache always should make you suspect an intracranial hypertension or a hypotension. If there's a precipitation of sneezing, cough, or exercise, posterior fossa malformations and Chiari malformation should always be thought of, as also should be raised or decreased intracranial pressure. Presence of papillary edema suggests an intracranial tumor, and progressive headache and atypical presentations should always make you suspect a neoplasm and intracranial lesions. Headache in a patient's pregnancy or in the puerperal period should always make us suspect vascular disorders and postdural puncture headaches. If it is pre-delivery, also suspect pre-eclampsia. And another suspicion should always be kept in mind is a cerebral sinus thrombosis, since this can present as an acute onset headache in the pregnancy or puerperal time. A patient with painful eye with autonomic features can suggest pathology in the posterior fossa, the pituitary region, especially if it's a pituitary tumor with apoplexy, or a cavernous sinus thrombosis or a tumor should also be thought of. Post-traumatic headache can be acute and chronic, and subdural hematoma should always be considered, and can present indolently. And if there's a pathology of the immune system such as HIV, opportunistic infection always be thought of. If there's a history of painkiller overuse or new drug at onset of headache, medication overuse headache should always be suspected. So when we look at all these cases that we have seen first, in the first case, there's this red flag that the pain seems worse if he has been standing for some time and is better if he lies on. There is a postural change in the headache. And also there is increase whenever he coughs or sneezes. This is a suggestive that it's either a posterior fossa tumor or raised or decreased intracranial pressure. In this patient, it turned out to be a intracranial hypotension, and with the history that he has had tackle, which can lead to a subdural leak. And the second patient, the red flags which we should have picked up are that the patient wakes up with headache. Should always make us suspect a malignant cause. And also the worsening of the headache on bending forward and on coughing and straining at stools. These are all clues that there's a raise in the intracranial pressure. The blackening of the vision, that is usually brief and usually associated with bending forward, is a very good clue that there is a raised intracranial pressure, and the clinical examination showing a bilateral papillary edema confirms the same. Here, the drug history is important since the presence of lithium should make us suspect a drug-induced intracranial hypertension. In the third patient, the patient had an increase of the pain on coughing and straining at stools. Again, this is a clue for increased intracranial pressure.
Okay.
And examination showed a pronator drift. So this is a localized clinical deficit. In this patient, the drug history is even more important since there's intake of antiplatelets. Any history of intake of antiplatelets or anticoagulants always make us suspect an intracranial bleed, is even with the trivial trauma. Sometime in this patient, he was able to recall a trivial trauma which he had 2 months back. Usually patients will forget trauma and they will deny any history of trauma, but you should always have the high index of suspicion and go for imaging. In the fourth patient, here the red flag says that she just delivered her first day, that she is in the puerperal period. The headache was sudden and nonstop.
Sorry to interrupt.
She had recurrent vomiting without nausea. This is a projectile vomiting. So these are all again clues that it's a malignant cause, with examination showing blurring of the temporal margin, showing possibility of a raised intracranial pressure. So this turned out to be an superior sinus thrombosis with raised AICP. So in this fifth patient, the flags are that the headache was sudden and onset on the day, and it is neck stiff presentation, and he is irritated on looking at light, that, which means that he is having photophobia. These are all clues that possible. Yes?
Sorry, we are slightly over the time. If you can just give the finish it quickly, yeah. It might be helpful just to contain the time.
Yeah, I'm just
fine. Thank you.
So here you have that the pupils was abnormal. And the sixth patient with the migraine, there were no red flags and everything was just continuation of the previous causes. And other things you have to look for, I just skip through them. So the index of time. So thunderclap headache always needs urgent imaging and can present with many of the vascular causes. And the location of the headache can also be a clue to occur to the underlying cause. And the important things in the history is that you take a proper history and you need to take time to get the history and look at the changes with the position and the changes with the cough, and also look at the distribution and neurological deficits. And drug history is also important in all these patients. And examination, always look at least a focused, simple examination is necessary to rule out secondary causes. You have to look at the drug history, since many of the drugs can cause iatrogenic hypertension. And these are the more important clues which I want to mention, is red herrings, that even though it can look like it's a secondary cause, usually it turned out to be a primary headache. That is, hemiplegia can occur in headache in familial hemiplegic migraine. Focal deficits can be a part of aura of migraine. Severe pain and vomiting can present as a syncope and make us misdiagnose even my simple migraine. And non-responsiveness does not rule out a primary headache. And systemic signs of fever also exacerbate underlying primary headaches. And some Trojan horses, that is simple, that is the headaches mimicking a primary headache, which are usually due to an underlying malignant cause. Especially a long-standing episodic headaches can be secondary, as seen in IEH and SIH. Simple analgesics can sometimes be effective even in secondary headaches. And unilateral pain can occur due to raised ICP. Typical migraine-like headache can occur in episodic attacks and CADASIL. And short-duration headaches can be secondary, especially if the patients have specific triggers such as position change and cough. So take-home messages which I want to mention here are: proper history and examination are very useful to predict risk of underlying malignant cause. Should always have a low threshold for imaging, that is, and if prefer an MRI to a CT, except for suspected bleeds. And normal imaging does not always rule out a malignant cause. So when in doubt, always refer to a neurologist. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivas. We now invite some questions from the members to Dr. Srinivas. There is already one question in the chat box, Dr. Srinivas. He is asking, Dr. Ramachandran is asking, if are all headaches, do they require an MRI, even migraine?
No. So preferably, we don't need to do an imaging for all headaches. If you can find any of these red flags I was mentioning, then we could go for imaging immediately. Preferably, all patients with migraine should have at least one imaging sometime in the disease course, just for completion's sake. But usually, we do not need it as an urgent basis.
Are there any questions more for Dr. Srinivas?
Can you comment on how hypertension and migraine coexist, and what kind of precautions a hypertensive patient with migraine should take?
There is no definite evidence that both of them can exacerbate each other, but usually hypertension presenting as headache is very rare unless the BP is very high. That is our, and it should be an acute rise in BP. So if chronic hypertensives, usually, even if they have a very high BP, they do not present with headache as such. So if even in a chronic hypertensive with uncontrolled hypertension, unless it has been a sudden rise in the blood pressure, the headache is unlikely to be due to the hypertension, and it is more likely a presentation of a primary headache disorder such as migraine. And coming to the association with migraine, there is no specific association as such, but most of the causes, any underlying systemic disorder can precipitate an attack of migraine. So it is better that patients always rule out specific triggers. Uncontrolled hypertension and any systemic illness can precipitate an attack of migraine. So that should always be kept in mind.
Are there any more questions? So Dr. Bhupathi, sir. Sir, we can't hear you, sir. You're muted. There is one more question for you, Dr. Srinivas. Migraine associated with PMS.
If that is definitively migraine, we would look at the presentation, look at the frequency of the migraine. If it is only during the premenstrual time, your patient may take, and if it is mild, you should advise only abortive medications during the attack. Unless it is debilitating, preventive medications are not necessary. If the headache is very severe and the patient feels unable to do her activities of daily living, even during a single attack, maybe then the patient can be given some preventive medications. Other than that, usually abortive medications at the onset of headache is usually enough.
Srinivas, nice presentation, Srinivas. I'd like to ask you one question, because the migraine is a very, very nagging problem. Everyone wants to get rid of the headache, because once you get headache only, then we know the severity of the problem. Otherwise, palluvali vandu unudha palluvali patti theriy apdipadi pole. The migraine is a very, very nagging problem. So my question is, then what is the current medication to relieve the acute migraine, and what are the good medication to prevent the relapse of migraine?
Yes, sir. So I agree, sir. I am also a migrainer, so I know how difficult it is to deal with migraine. So usually the medications depend on the severity and the frequency, sir. If it is a very rare migraine that you get only 2 to 3 headaches a month, usually you don't have to give any preventive medications. And during the onset of the attack, the abortive drugs can be given. It depends. Many patients respond to a single dose of paracetamol also. So if they keep responding only to paracetamol, that is more than enough. But what happens is, over the course of time, they get resistant to paracetamol. They may need stronger medications. Preferably, we use NSAIDs, which is good. The other drugs which I give are the triptans, but triptans have a lot of side effects, so we should be careful, especially in older individuals, due to the vascular side effects. And what we usually prefer to avoid are the opioid drugs, since it can have they can lead to the formation of medication-induced headaches. Triptans and opioids, if they keep using again and again, they will lead to medication overuse headache, which becomes very difficult to treat. So preferably, paracetamol and NSAIDs are the initial preferred drugs of choice.
There's one more question in the chat box from Dr. Ganapriya. For chronic headache associated with PMS for long years, how do we advise, please?
If the headache is definitely debilitating during the each attack, we suggest that they can be started on anti-migraine medications. depending on the patient's profile and any new other drugs which can which are being used, the preferred drugs which we now give are beta blockers is the usually the first line unless they are contraindicated. Antidepressants have tricyclic antidepressants are also used. SSRIs can also be used, and the drug and if the, we prefer the this preventive medications only if the frequency is high and if the headaches are debilitating. Other than that, you can go with abortive medications as well.
Great. I think there, Dr. Mylappan has asked this question: beta blockers and migraine. So,
beta blockers are a very good first drug of choice for preventive as a preventive medication for migraine, and it is. We do prefer it as the first choice, especially if there are no contraindications to use. Since there are many contraindications, especially in older individuals.
I think yes, sir, the questions on headache will be never ending. But then we will take one last question from Dr. B. Srinivas. He said that when he started jogging, his migraines dropped. So your comments
on that. Yes, sir. You are completely right, sir. It's healthy lifestyle is shown to improve your headaches. All types of headaches are shown to improve with the healthy lifestyle. Even myself, I have had the same experience with decrease in my frequency. So having a healthy lifestyle and proper eating habits are very important to avoid triggering headaches, especially migraines.
Great.